Hi, Representative Nixon. Welcome. Thanks so much for joining us. I think that's our lineup. So we're going to go ahead and get started. We already have some media and journalists listening in. So thank you so much to everyone from joining us here today. My name is Jess Jollett, and I'm the Executive Director of Progress North Carolina Action. So Progress is a hub of communications professionals that support progressive campaigns and organizations here in the state of North Carolina. I'm just really excited to join my friends and colleagues from across the state and also from Florida today. We're having a joint press conference as a response to the appearance of Governor Ron DeSantis at the North Carolina GOP State Convention, which is happening right now in Greensboro, and the recognition of the draconian values that both DeSantis and our own Lieutenant Governor and GOP gubernatorial candidate Mark Robinson share. We collectively know that the discriminatory policies of the GOP leadership do not represent the people of our states, and they are a threat to the future of our nation. Both DeSantis and Robinson share radical positions on banning books, censoring honest discussion about history and race, and targeting vulnerable LGBTQ students that will undermine our educational system and simply just bring us backwards. So we said yes to hosting today's press conference because here at Progress, we are extremely clear-eyed about the consequences of what a Robinson governorship would be for North Carolinians. His hate-filled rhetoric and his sustained disinterest in a working government is not the type of leadership we need or frankly deserve. Today, you're going to hear from some elected leaders and also local leaders, including Representative Anna V. Escamani, Representative Angie Nixon from Florida, and from our own home state, we're going to hear from Senator Greg Meyer and the CEO of the New North Carolina Project, Amy Steele. We really appreciate y'all joining us here today, and I'm going to be happy to take some questions at the end of our call. So with no further ado, I'm going to pass the microphone to Representative Escamani to get us started. Representative?
Well, thank you so much, Jessica, for having me. And of course, to my colleagues in Florida and North Carolina, it's an honor to share stage with you every single day. I think these types of multi-state convenings are really important because we're seeing trends across America, battles happening in our legislative chambers, and of course, in the governor offices as well, that are stripping away the needs of everyday people, taking away our freedoms, while also, of course, dismantling important and essential institutions like public education. So again, my name is Anna V. Escamani. I am so proud to serve District 42 in the Florida State House Legislature. For those that are not familiar with that district, it basically encompasses the heart of Orange County, Florida. So that includes Orlando, Winter Park, Belle Isle, Edgewood, Maitland, and the historic town of Eatonville. I represent a very diverse community, a very diverse district within a diverse state. And we stand alongside community members of every economic experience, of every race, gender, and of course, sexual orientation in ensuring that you have the opportunity to reach your fullest potential. And that doesn't happen in a state run by Governor Ron DeSantis. And in fact, if he's even here, because now he's campaigning for president, so we don't even see DeSantis these days, he is continuously perpetuating culture wars that divide us, targeting already marginalized people, bullying LGBTQ plus youth. And meanwhile, while he leads in this way, so many of our just everyday institutions are neglected and dismantled. And I really want to just take a moment to not only talk about the governor's extreme agenda on issues like banning abortion at 6 weeks or stripping away access to gender-affirming care or targeting our immigrant community members who are also an essential workforce, but I want to really focus on public education, which is our society's ultimate equalizer. You know, I'm a public school grad, K-12. I went to the University of Central Florida, and we are experiencing major privatization of public schools in Florida and also book banning alongside suffocating our educators. So they don't want to stay and work in Florida anymore because of how politicized public education has become. To highlight how this does not just impact the K-12 environment, I'm going to reference New College as an example. New College is one of our public universities in Florida that's gone through a hostile conservative takeover by Governor DeSantis and his lackeys. And they've inserted not just unqualified individuals to lead these institutions, but they've inserted grifters, people who have who have continuously privatized public education while they make money along the way. And we are seeing just some of our most prestigious institutions be eroded. Students leaving in droves, faculty don't want to come in anymore. But we just saw our education systems huge economic consequences. And here's one of those moments where you mess around and you find out. And that has been a constant pattern of Governor Ron DeSantis, where he pursues a culture war battle and then there are consequences. His attacks on the Walt Disney World Company, one of our largest employers in the state, has led to not only the state being sued, but now we're seeing different conventions get canceled in Florida because different groups, they don't want to be in a state where freedoms are stripped away, where LGBTQ people are under attack, and when they can't be their authentic selves safely. And of course, his attacks on immigrants are now leading to our construction job sites being half full to individuals who are laboring in our fields, not feeling safe coming to Florida anymore, looking towards other migration patterns in this country. And so it's not only just an altruistic belief that many of us hold that we should have a society that loves and cares about every person, but it also has huge economic consequences because diversity is a smart business practice. What isn't smart is continuously to use your political positions as weapons of the state to marginalize, isolate, and to divide people just for your own political ambitions. And so as I pass it to my colleague in North Carolina, Greg Myers, I just want to emphasize that these are not individuals that you want in higher office. And this extremism is being rejected by the American people. And I feel confident it will be rejected in Florida as well. You know, we're seeing many Republicans that are turning towards progress and away from divisiveness, who don't support things like a 6-week abortion ban or interfering in LGBTQ plus healthcare or don't agree with the targeting of workers in the context of the demonization of immigrants. You don't like the fact that we're spending millions of dollars on litigation on constitutional laws and at the same time trafficking immigrants to other states. And so we stand together in solidarity on a more prosperous community, on a more prosperous nation, one that is focused on solving problems, not creating problems. And with that, I'll pass it to my colleague in North Carolina.
Thank you, Representative Escamani. And I agree with you that Republican leaders like Mark Robinson and Ron DeSantis are taking us farther and farther away from what most people in North Carolina, Florida, and all over the United States are willing to tolerate. And we need to put a stop to that and make sure that we're taking care of our communities. I entered politics 10 years ago after spending my career working in North Carolina's public schools. And I care deeply still about what happens in those public schools because I've got one kid who's made it all the way through them and five more who still depend on our public schools every day. And so I'm in the North Carolina General Assembly and representing Senate District 23, trying to make sure that we continue to love and protect our public schools and the children that they serve. Meanwhile, you have folks like Mark Robinson and Ron DeSantis who are using schools to divide us, using schools as a political weapon in a way that fundamentally breaks the compact we have that public education is where we come together, that public education is where we learn to be Americans, where we learn how to live up to the ideals of this country, and where we prepare children for our world, both to be ready to make a living and take care of their families, and to contribute to a healthy and functioning democracy. But what Mark Robinson and Ron DeSantis want to do by pushing book bans and whitewashing history is they want to use those schools as a weapon for division, and they're hurting our public education in a way that ultimately will hurt all of us. Here in North Carolina, we currently have a 5,000 teacher shortage. 5,000 teachers. That's kids in every school district in the state who don't have a certified teacher in front of them every day. Every school district that I talk to, every principal is begging for mental health resources. We have over $8 billion in school construction needs. Parents are having to scramble on an average morning to figure out how to get their kids to school because we don't have enough bus drivers, because our pay for bus drivers and even for teachers hasn't kept up with market pay for professionals like garbage truck drivers, who make more on average than both our bus drivers and our teachers. And our parents are more worried about their children's safety in school from gun violence than they are from any threats posed by books. Simply put, if you ask parents in North Carolina, in Florida, or elsewhere, what do they want in schools? They will tell you they want more books and fewer guns, because that's what our children need to succeed. And we as people need to remember that it is our shared interest to come together through public schools, to love and protect those schools and the children in them for the betterment of our entire democracy. That is a fundamental purpose of government, and we should never trust any leader who's trying to break that compact for their own political gain. I'd now like to pass it over to Representative Angie Nixon from Florida to talk more about what's been learned from Governor DeSantis's failures there.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Senator Meyer. I'm State Representative Angie Nixon in Florida House District 13. I've been a community organizer and an advocate for public education for over 12 years in the state of Florida. Over the past few years, we've witnessed countless attacks on our public education system in Florida, with Republican Governor Ron DeSantis leading the charge. As not only a state rep, but a mother of five children, I am appalled by the current state of our education system here in Florida. Instead of working to ensure that Florida, the third largest state in the country, has fully resourced public schools, quality educators, and well-funded mental health programs, we instead have a governor who is so hell-bent on ending public education as we know it. DeSantis has led the charge to defund public districts that dare to keep our children safe by implementing mask mandates when he was issuing mask bans to appease his political base during the COVID pandemic. We're currently facing a mass exodus of educators and over 8,000 shortage, including paraprofessionals and support staff, because of the divisive rhetoric, the culture wars, and overall false narrative he's spreading regarding what our educators are teaching our children. Look, Governor DeSantis is banning books, the teaching of true history, and so much more. Not to mention the fact that he has now signed into law HB 1, a bill that they disguise the school choice, but as some experts state, will gut the public education system as we know it. This bill, modeled after bills in Arizona and New Hampshire, will now allow billionaires and millionaires, y'all heard me right, billionaires and millionaires to take nearly $10,000 a year from public schools to pay for their child to attend private corporate schools. And that ain't right. Which are allowed, you know, these schools are often allowed to discriminate against students. They hire uncertified teachers, and they're not required to take the same standardized tests that our students in public schools have to take. Please tell me, where is the parity? That is not even the worst of it all. The two states this bill was modeled after, Arizona and New Hampshire, their costs exceeded their projections by 1,500% in Arizona and 6,000% in New Hampshire. The governor states that this bill in Florida is only expected to cost a few hundred million dollars. Well, the Florida Policy Institute estimates the true cost will be $4 billion. Talk about a blow to public education. Now let's discuss higher education in our state of Florida. Governor DeSantis seems to love hostile takeovers. He's removed school board members that didn't align with his ideology. He's removed a state attorney that didn't comply with his ideology. And now he's taking over colleges and universities by stacking their boards with close allies, trying to stump out things like diversity, equity, and inclusion. He pushed a bill last year that even hides the identity of candidates applying for college president's positions. And now we have former state electeds and current state electeds that are the governor's allies serving or about to serve in these roles. Not only that, but he's also pushed legislation banning DEI courses, as State Rep Ana Escamani stated earlier, gender studies, African-American studies, and intersectionality. He's made massive changes to tenure review. Schools can't use funds on DEI programs or programs that support social justice. Look, these incessant attacks are not only attacks on our academic freedoms, but there are attacks on our freedom to live in our state. DeSantis is trying to control how the populace thinks and lives their lives. And now he's gallivanting across the country when instead he should be worried about the fact that working families can no longer afford Florida and they are underwater, both figuratively and literally. I.e. when South Florida was underwater due to record setting flooding, but Governor DeSantis was in Iowa pandering for votes. Lord only knows what's going to happen this hurricane season. This is not the type of governance you should want in your state. Every day I have folks reaching out to me about the fear they have living in our state, actual fear that they will be attacked or starved or left out in the cold or heat without a roof over their head. Like I have warned and will continue to warn Americans, I will now warn those in North Carolina. North Carolina, you are in danger, girl. DeSantis and Mark Robinson are not what you want. And next, I would like to kick it over to Ms. Amy Steele, who's the CEO of New North Carolina Actions First.
Thank you so much, Representative. I am deeply moved by your remarks, and you're absolutely right. I am Dr. Amy Steele, former teacher, K-12 Spanish teacher, and school principal right here in North Carolina. I'm a product of public education from K-12 all the way to college, and I've obtained a PhD in curriculum and instruction. So I know curriculum and I know instruction, and I know the process by which we should be teaching our students. I also have 5 kids who proudly attend public schools in North Carolina and across the nation. So their education is one of my primary focuses. After running for office to really help address some major concerns in public education, including class size legislation back in 2017, that positively impacted K-3 class sizes, but negatively impacted the class sizes of students in grades 4 through 7, I founded the New North Carolina Project Action First to ensure the public was aware of the need to get out and vote in every election, every time, to help turn the tide in the areas of public education and proper funding for our school system. What prompted me to run for office was this harmful classroom size legislation, because those issues caused tremendous harm and hurt in my school where I served as principal, including forcing me to consider using the school's media center, the gymnasium, the cafeteria, the music room, and the art room as classrooms to be able to comply with this legislation. So harmful legislation like this, as well as discriminatory practices proposed by Robinson, is precisely what North Carolina does not need. We don't need Robinson in leadership. The Republican budget drains funding for public schools. It fails to address below average teacher pay, which I was a victim of. And it also prioritizes millionaires instead of the average North Carolinian. Republicans, with the blessing of Mark Robinson, are looking to set back our schools for a generation, and that is not okay. The Republican budget and extreme agenda cuts mental health funding, it spews hate, and it defies the true identity of students, and that's not okay. Just like we don't need politicians in our doctor's offices, we certainly don't need politicians like Mark Robinson and Ron DeSantis in our kids' classrooms. Robinson's leadership would exacerbate our teacher pipeline issue and lead to a lack of quality teachers as they continue getting attacked in classes, having disproportionate amounts of grievances filed against them daily by extreme hate groups and other things prompting these great teachers to leave the profession. Robinson's lack of understanding of how teaching and schools actually work is astounding. Teachers need to be trusted to work with parents and not against them as they provide the work together, work to provide the best quality education for their children. From a discriminatory perspective, I can say that cruel and unusual policies proposed by Republicans like DeSantis and Mark Robinson are really causing more and more students and teachers to be centered as the victims of discrimination, of hate crimes, of school mass shootings, and harmful daily practices, leading students, especially racially diverse students and students who identify as LGBTQIA+, to consider self-harm and really not even see themselves represented in society or in their schools. These feelings of isolation must be addressed with increased funding for school psychologists, for counselors, social workers, and support staff who can help meet the demands of today's youth, especially coming out of COVID. From a censorship perspective, Robinson is using his bully pulpit to engage in culture wars. This is causing the banning of books, as we've heard, and trying to control what teachers and educators use to impart true history and true knowledge to their students. so they can adequately see themselves represented in books and literature. And it's just not okay for him to continue doing that. The term linked fate applies where students link their fate to those whom they see in positive positions of power and success. As a former teacher, I relied on a variety of resources and of examples of leadership to be able to teach my students Spanish so that my students could develop a thirst for knowledge, a quest for truth, and an overall thorough understanding of the subject matter. I fear that policies put in place by Robinson will lead to that turning back. From a funding perspective, cutting funding for public education hurts our kids the most. When teachers come to school after having fought all week against their curriculum and instructional planning, as well as the regular daily encounters of being a teacher, they truly feel increasingly overwhelmed with having to do more with less. With proper funding, as Robinson specifically encouraged the cutting of public education funding to make room for vouchers in private schools and parochial schools, without that proper funding, I fear that our education as it stands is just not going to be sustainable. We can't keep milking the system. In conclusion, we should be focused on fully funding our public schools so they have the staff and the resources they need to give all students the freedom to be healthy, to be prosperous, and to be safe. And I'll turn it over to my colleague, Jess, from Progress NC.
Thank you, Dr. Steele, and thank you to all our speakers. We really appreciate your time. For those attending our webinar today, if you have a question, we'll take a few minutes to see that. You simply need to press the Q&A button at the bottom of the Zoom screen, and the question will come up on my end. Just give folks a moment to see if they do. Libby Dean, I see you there, so I'm going to allow you to talk and ask your question. Hold on 1 second. Okay, you should be there.
Hey there.
Hi.
So I have a question. I'm actually with a station, WFLA, out of Tampa, Florida. And I would just want to ask y'all, as DeSantis is, you know, in y'all's state today, we're expecting, obviously, a reaction from him on the Trump indictment. We already saw it via Twitter, but I would like y'all's comments on that as well as he's traveling there today.
Great. Thanks, Libby. I'll pass it to my colleagues. Senator Meyer, I don't know if you have a statement.
I mean, Ron DeSantis, every other Republican running for president, and every Republican should call on President Trump to step back from running for any political office until his legal troubles are done. And if they don't, then they are choosing to keep going with President Trump as their most likely nominee to be the president of the United States of America. And I can't wait to see what erupts at the convention, the GOP convention here this weekend, as people have to draw and take sides on this. But if you're looking out for what's the good of America, it is very clear that we do not need President Trump under indictment, running for political office, or possibly elected to be president of the United States once again.
Thank you, Senator. Do any of other speakers have statements to add to that? Okay.
Hey, it's Rebecca Scamani. I'm driving, but I just want to echo that. But also, I mean, it's the extremism on the right and just the absurdity of it all is historic, really. I mean, this is the first former president ever to face these types of criminal charges, or any criminal charges for that matter. And the fact that, you know, he's a front runner, I think it just speaks to the extremism that many of our Republican colleagues are trying to cultivate. And we don't need that in our states. We don't need that in this country. And so it's why we see so many Republican everyday people turning away from their party and looking towards other options, because it really is isolating them. And for a party that perpetuates law and order, they seem to know a lot about lawlessness. I mean, whether it's, you know, Congressman George Santos, or in this case, former President Trump.
Thank you, Representative. Any other questions from the media? Okay, I just want to remind everyone that we are going to share this recording and have it on our respective YouTube channels with my colleagues in Florida and here at Progress. So folks should be getting an email from us with a link if they need to revisit any of the statements or share it with any other colleagues in the newsroom.
Jess, I'm sorry. I just, yes. Listening to my colleague, she got me agitated.
Yes, please. No,
she got me agitated to speak. And so, it's crazy because Ron DeSantis he doesn't even have the moral courage to condemn Donald Trump.
Yes.
And so based on all these documents and everything like that. So what kind of president would he be? So that just goes to show you the Republican Party, many of its members, they are corrupt. And it just shows that Ron DeSantis really cares more about his political ambitions as opposed to really the people of our country. Y'all already see how he's treating us in the state of Florida. So it's only going to be worse if he was to become president. And so we definitely have to stop him in his tracks right now.
Well, I'm glad you added that in, Representative, because I feel like that's a really wonderful statement. So thank you so much. Okay, y'all, that concludes our time together. Thank you so much. Again, thank you so much to our speakers who took the time this morning from their busy schedules and all of our colleagues in the newsroom that joined us. We hope you all have a wonderful day. Be safe.
Thank you.
Bye, y'all.
Thanks. Bye.